நந்தி அருளாலே நாதனாம் பேர் பெற்றோம். நந்தி அருளாலே மூலனை நாடினோம். நந்தி அருளாவது என் செய்யும் நாட்டினில் நந்தி வழிகாட்ட நான் இருந்தேனே. நமஸ்காரம். I welcome you all for this evening's lecture on architecture and choreography. Today is a very auspicious day, the Panguni Uthira Thirunal. In Thiruvarur, Lord Sri Thyagaraja Swami reveals his Pada Darsanam today. It's a very important and a significant darshana for a Shaiva devotee. And this particular practice has been fostered for centuries. This particular cult of Sri Thyagaraja Swami has been thriving in Thiruvarur for many years, maybe aeons, we don't know. Such Thiruvarurs, such Chidambarams, such Kumbakonams and such Tanjavurs have been thriving on a very balanced resonance of many form of knowledge put together, what we call them as, or what we have bifurcated them as, science and art. Archaeology, history, philosophy, music, dance, every part of knowledge seamlessly seems to coexist in these places. Architecture and choreography at the outset seems to be totally two disconnected area. What is so common about them? Is there any commonality between them? Any form of scientific invention or artistic expression is a transformation of the intangible asset of the humanity called the concept, the thought, or the tattva, which gets converted into a tangible product. This product could be either static or dynamic. This tattva or concept undergoes a cyclic reaction. This transformation reaction is certainly a cyclic reaction where in presence of human intervention and thought, this idea gets converted into intense thought process. This intense thought process gets later converted into sampradaya or practicals, which later gets documented into shastras or text. From shastras, we get newer ideas. This entire chain reaction would be fostered by a catalyst called dhyana, or seamless attention. Such seamless attention of great people has given us many valuable set of knowledge, such as two different things, what you're going to discuss as architecture and choreography. There is no big difference between a chemical reaction or a mathematical formula or a dhyana shlokam, which describes the form of Kamakshi, Chaturbhuje, Chandrakalavatamshi, Kuchonate, Kunkumaragashone, Pundra Ikshu, Pasha Ankusha, Pushpavana Haste, Namaste Jagadeka Mataha. Is there a difference between this and an equation like E is equal to mc square devised by Einstein? Such intense thought process is common, and such reactions, such conversion reactions is common to science as well as so-called art. That brings the space between scientists and artists very close to each other. Rather, in Indian context, there is no difference, absolutely no difference between an erudite scientist and an erudite artist. These extremely valuable information of science and art and these scientists, we have fortunately, or rather unfortunately, have called them as rishis and munis, and their contribution has been restricted to the areas of religion, myth, legend, and belief system around it, rather. This tattva, or the concept, gets converted into a static expression when it comes to architecture, and a dynamic expression when it comes to choreography. A very intense years and years of dhyanam of a rishi could transform the concept of life into bijaksharas and mantras. If years and years of concentrated dhyanam of a philosopher could translate his realization of life into sutras, if years and years of dhyanam of an architect could transform the entire structure into a Brahma Sutram, a single line, if years and years of dhyanam of a musician could transform his sense of music into swaras, then years and years of dhyanam of a dancer has transformed the form into a perfect natyarambam and an aramandi. If simplified beyond this point, the art form ceases to exist. Another interesting common understanding between architecture and choreography is that their experts in the respective field have utmost understanding of human body. Tirumular goes to praise the body. There is one quote which I want to quote, which is from Mayamatam, written by Mayan, says, Garbhagraha shirah proktam, antaralam galam tata, mandapam cha mukhe bahu, kukshisyat mandapo mahan, prakaram janu jangecha, gopuram padamevacha, padasyangulah prokta, gopuram stupayastata, which means, the Garbhagraha is the head, the antarala is the neck, the Ardha Mandapa is the chest. The Maha Mandapa is the abdomen. The hands and the leg become the Prakara. The Gopuram becomes the feet. Indirectly, we say a temple is nothing but a human body, or vice versa, a human body is nothing but a temple. A temple is an anthropomorphic representation of a human body. That human, the large, huge, humongous human, is called as Sri Purusha, or the universal man. Such universal representations, in want of understanding, in want of personal understanding, we have reduced them into microcosmic level in terms of dance. Let's see how an Odissi dancer has taken it into their hands. They keep a small ornament called tahiya on the top of the head, which symbolizes the shikara of Puri Jagannath temple. By placing that on their head, their body becomes the Puri Jagannath temple, and their soul becomes the heart place where Puri Jagannath resides. Henceforth, if body is the temple, then dance is nothing but temple in motion. Temple in motion, the hands and legs become the moving mandala. Every rekas and rajas and the sutras vibrate and pulsate not to any random fashion, but to the universal music of talam and ragam. It's orchestrated, perfectly orchestrated, as we say that. If that body has the spirit within it, Tirumalar goes to says, Udambin ulle, Uttaman koil kondan endru udambai yanirundu ombugindrene. Since I realized that the universal power lives within my body, I foster my body, I respect my body. Many several authors of ancient genre, many centuries ago, the classic authors, whosoever wrote on philosophy also wrote on yoga. Whosoever wrote on yoga also wrote on music. Whosoever wrote on music also wrote on dance. And whosoever wrote on dance also wrote on theater. Something pretty interesting, they also wrote on medicine and body. Classic example for them are Tirumular, Agastya, Mayan, Patanjali, and so on. The list goes unending. Another common feature for dance, per se, choreography and architecture, is the word talam. This word talam, in architectural parlance, is the basic measurement of space. In architecture, you measure space by talam. In choreography, dance and music, you measure time by talam. Space and time being two independent entities in our outlook, but modern science disagrees. According to quantum physics, it has been proven that space and time are interdependent quantities and can be quantified according to dipolar theory, and even Heisenberg uncertainty principle proves this point very clearly. Probably our ancestors understood it long back. Body and its soul. Such an interesting what will happen to a body without a soul? So naturally, we have to speak about soul when we speak about the body. Rather, when we speak about the temple, we have to speak about the divine power living within it. Ullam perungoyil, oon udambu alayam, vallal piranarku, vai gopura vasal, tellat telindarku, jeevan sivalingam, kallapulan aindum kala manivilakke. The heart is the Shri Kovil. The entire body is a big temple. The Jeevan, the main spirit, is nothing but the Shivalingam. Then the five-headed lamb wards off the darkness of ignorance. It's interesting how this Jeevan is created, or the Shivalinga, or the Mula Vigraha is created. Creating a Mula Vigraha is nothing, is equivalent to creation of a soul, of a Jeevan. If I say one has created, if Mula Vigraham is equal to Jeevan, creation of a Mula Vigraham is same as creation of Jeevan. Let us see how Astapati creates a Mula Vigraha. He is asked to lead a life of celibacy. He is resigned from his family, comes to the temple premises, stays there for days and days. He selects appropriate stone. For him, it is not a stone. For him, it is the circuit, it is the diagram, it is the place where the divine forces come to go and exist, they're going to live. It's going to bless us for centuries together. So he is very careful in selecting that particular kalam. He calls it a kalam. This stone is kept in front of him, and he meditates upon it for maybe for 40 days, 80 days, 120 days, till the point he realizes that the Devi has already started living in that stone. Is according to traditional Tapatis, their only job is to remove the dirt deposited on her. They bring back her to life. With his prana, he pours into the soul of the stone and brings back her to life. That's called prana pratishta. Then he opens her eyes with the process called nayana unmilanam, which happens not in the direct face of the goddess. He is asked to go behind the murti and open it with a chisel. Do you believe that is the eye, what you see in the goddess Kamakshi, and that is full of life? With my interaction with Stapati, they have said, even if you go behind the murti, sir, naanga pinnadi pona kuda enga devoda mugam pinnadi theriyunga sir. Appear pattavanga da moola vigrahatha sire seiya mudiyum, create panna mudiyum. It is an interesting fact, but when you start drawing a moola vigraham, the Stapati draws a perfect sketch. That first touch of a sketch, he cannot draw with a scale. There is no instrument you can use about. You can't use an instrument. You have to meditate before. You can meditate for many days, but the first stroke you put cannot be done. And the entire diagram is drawn without any help of any measurement and mensurations. If you draw the Brahma Sutram, it equally divides into 215 parts. Such is the intensity of a dhyanam. What is so different between this and a choreographer's work? A choreographer is given a space and mere moving bodies. He or she is asked to sculpt space, remove the unwanted, make the bodies, the elements, to move with talam, with musicality. And the work stands for posterity, for the next generation to see, to witness. At times, as we forget the name of the Stapati who created the Mula Vigraham, we also tend to forget the choreographer's name and the musical composer's name, but the composition stands for posterity. Indeed, there is an interesting understanding. After all these understandings, these great souls started thinking inward rather introvert. It's all said and done, yes, fine, agreed. But actually, what are we speaking about? That Parabrahman, which is Nityam, Nityananda, Anatimalamukta, Swatantra, Sarvajna, Sarvavyapta, Sarvakarta. Such a soul, such a Parabrahman we are speaking about. It is filled with compassion, anbu. Anbu Sivam, Irandenbar Arivilar. Anbe Sivamavadu, Yarum Arigilar. Anbe Sivamavadu, Yarum Arindapin. Anbe Sivamai Amarandirundare, says Tirumular. As architects and as choreographers, they understood I mean traditional architects and choreographers, they understood this particular aspect of coming together of self. You can't throw the self away and do a work. It would never exist. Be it music, dance, or architecture, painting, everything. It has to be associated with you. Any art form, any invention in the world, if it has no purpose or association with the self, howsoever beautiful it is bound to die. Various rishis and munis and various pontiffs of the world have started searching their self within. Such searches have led them to create these theories and concepts which we term as religion. Great kings and kingdoms agreed upon this and they fostered it. The greatest of the dynasties of South India, like Pallavas, Cholas, Vijayanagara, Nayakas and Marathas, fostered such excellent art piece, or you'd say their life. Such examples are very evident in the places like Mamallapuram, Kanchipuram, Tanjavur, Tarasuram, Tiruvanam, Hampi, Madurai, anywhere you go. They are living examples where life, movement, and structure come together. Iconography and symbology are very, very solid field which human created in order to connect architecture and choreography. Rather, to put in simpler terms, the most simplest form of connection between architecture and choreography is iconography and the symbology behind it. He found great truth, I'm saying about the human. Once he realized it, he was so anxious to represent it. Initially, his symbols were very weird. Rather, he was not satisfied with the symbol. He was constantly inventing, finding new avenues to represent his thought. Finally, he identified that his own self, his own form, could be the easiest form to communicate his thought. He identified a concept and he said, this particular concept can create. It can also distract, it can also preserve, it can also liberate, but how do I represent it? Henceforth, he gave a form of a human being. In one hand, he gave Damaru and he said, let it create. He imposed his job of destruction into the fire in the other hand. He said, this concept can also create and preserve. Then he had Abhayhastam in one hand. And he said, it can also give deliverance. So let us lift the other leg. Henceforth, he saw himself as a dancing form. This vibration, this spandana, has been represented in many ways. Basically, the three facets of representation happened. This we call as three forms of dance according to Tholkapiyam. Nindradal, Amarandadal, Kidandadal. It is nothing but a transition between Akasha Tattva to Prithvi Tattva. The most significant of it, which I feel, is the middleman, our Tyagaraja Swami or Soma Skanda Rupam. Soma Skanda is Shiva, Uma and Skanda put together. This is our Tyagaraja Swami who resides in Tiruvarur. In a place like Tiruvarur, which has been fostered, as I told you today, as Panguni Uttaram, for every devotee, he is a living king. Tiruvarur is a place with 131 sannidhis. The main vigraha, or the mulasthana, is called as Periya Koil. In Shaivite parlance, when you say I'm going to Periya Koil, it doesn't mean you're going to Tanjavur, you're going to Tiruvarur. When you say you're going to Koil, you go to Chidambaram then. The Utsava Veeram of Tiruvarur is Sri Tyagaraja Swami. There is a whole lot of cult associated with Tyagaraja Swami. It's very deep. In this sannidhi, in this particular sthalam, it seems that Navagraha stand in a straight line. All the nine lamps in front of Sri Tyagaraja Swami are nine Navagrahas always constantly praying to him. Srimati Rukmini Devi, one of the greatest choreographers of the previous century, in her choreographic work has represented the architecture of the temple, the philosophy behind it, the essence of the cult in a very, very most simplistic way that she has left it the way it is, and probably left it for people like us, the younger generations, to understand it more. The more the simpler a composition is, understanding and getting it into a form becomes more difficult, rather. A best exposition of one of her choreographies is, which according to my impression, is this Varnam in Ragam Todi, Talam Adi, a composition of Kannasami Nattuvanar of Thiruvarur, Rupamu Joochi Valachi Vachitini, in which the dancer, Rakesh, would now interpret only a small phrase of Sri Tyagaraja Swami Idemi.
Shri Tyagaraja Swami Idemi.
In the temple roads of Thiruvarur, in front of the Kira Gopuram, there is an Alukal Mandapam. Lord Sri Tyagaraja Swami would never leave the temple in the Eastern Gopuram. He would always take the small vasal called Vitta Vasal, also called as Thitti Vasal. Why? There are two or three different reasons given to it. One of the classic reasons is that is the Isana Mulai. And that's the direction where Sri Kamalambal is directly facing, in order to get her yogic power, because she is a Nitya Yogini and he is Bhogatyagesar. In order to get annually once, he takes his pradakshina there, he sends Chandrasekhara. Instead of he going outside, he sends Chandrasekhara as his representative. He takes the Kale Vahanam, Malvidai, he mounts it, takes the side road and comes to the center Nalukal Mandapam and bestows grace. The dancer says, Sri Tyagaraja Swami, what is this? Now let's go to the next hand. This hand could be easily misunderstood for the representation of Ardhanarishvara, but the cult of Tyagaraja Swami or Tyagarahasyam says as Tyagaraja Swami and Nilotpalambal, who is in the form of a flower, Nilotpalam, is next to him. The eye of Tyagaraja Swami is tilted little to the left from the icon's point of view, and the eye of Kamalambal is little towards right. She is called as Kondi Amman. Kandu kandu kadalithu ival kondi aayinal appdin navakarasar paadrar. Appa irupettu a subtle difference, and she is supposed to be not just the, you know, better half of Tyagaraja Swami, but Thirumular goes to quote that they are in constantly engaged in something called Pariyanka Yogam. Pariyankam endral kattil, a constant unison from tip of the head to the tip of the toe. When the body joins together, where even air cannot pass, then from one end you see this form, you mistake it to be Ardhanarishvara. Ardhanarishvara is nothing but, it's not a lateral attachment, but a physical attachment face to face. Rather, at that particular point, the spirit leaves the body and unites 12 inches above the head. That unison, that place is called as Nilotpalam, and the Ambal who helps Tyagaraja Swami to undergo this particular practice called as Nilotpalambal. Let's see the next hand. The tank of Thiruvarur is called as Kamalalayam. This tank is also called as Tapaharini or Ganga Hrita Teertham. one of the droplets from the head of Shiva fell in this place and took a form of a pond. This pond is supposed to vanquish all the tapas, the three tapas of the human beings. Why I chose these three hands are, in these three hands, the first hand you can see the temple architecture of Vittavasil being choreographed or being depicted. The second hand, the significance of the iconography of Tyagaraja Swami and Nirodhpanambal being depicted. In the third hand, you see the temple tank suggestively said how Ganga fell into the earth and became Kamalalayam. A seamless coming together of architecture, philosophy, symbolism, and dance. Now, I go on to present a Pallavi of a Padam. It's a Kirtanam, basically, composed by Papa Vinasa Mudaliyar in Ragam Bhairavi, Mishra Chaputalam, Mugatte Kati, Degam Muduvadam Kata, the Mudamandiram Yenaya, Jagatil Adigamana Aruri in Vasare, Seditha Menil, Unamundo Thyagesare. We are just going to do the Pallavi of it.
முகத்தை காட்டியே தேகம் முழுமையும் காட்டாத மூடு மந்திரம் ஏதை
It's interesting that the choreographer has chosen to enact the word deham not as this, but as this. Because Sri Tyagaraja Swami's deham is nothing but a golden plate in which the Hamsa mantra is etched and kept on his chest as Ulsathu. All the days in the year, his body is covered with flowers. Only his face will be visible to us. You can only take a darshanam of his face, not his body. Mugatte kaatiye, degam muduvadam kaattada, moodu mandiram ana hamsa mantram ennaya. It's a 51 akshara mantra, which has a higher philosophy to it. Rather, there is an epithet or an archana given to Sri Tyagaraja Swami as Sri Vidya Hamsa Samputaya Namaha. Where the choreographer has rightly chosen Samputa Hastra to show the secret which is hidden in the chest. Mugate Kaatiye Degam Sri Hridya Hamsa Samputa Mantrate Kaata the Vidya Innaya. I'm bringing the Kekra or indirect suggestion. Let's go to the next hand.
Mugate Kaatiye Degam.
This mantram is also called as Ponnana Mandiram or Ajapa Mantram. That's hidden in the chest of Sri Tyagaraja Swami. It's golden in color. Interesting enough, according to Abhinaya Darpanam, the Hasta Hamsasyo, the color of the Hasta is gold. And she has chosen it to interpret, even though the same Hasta is held in many ways, it has been hidden in the chest. So once again, she reiterates the fact of the rahasyam being hidden, but with another extra information saying that the color of the mantram is gold. I stop here. This topic and investigation could be, it can go on and on. I wish to say that such a work, such a choreographic feat, I would call, is coming together of many sources of knowledge, of architecture, of sculpture, of observation, of intrinsic thought and deep dhyanam of that particular great Atman. If not for her dhyanam on that particular piece or unseamless attention where I go to the first point what I quoted, a concept getting converted into a form, such choreographic feats would never be possible. I conclude. Architecture and choreography are conceptually the same, and they are outcome of intense thought process of humanity. One field draws inspiration from the other. One field finds the solution from the other for its unanswered question. They are bound by higher truth, they travel towards the same point and are expressions of human mind and centuries of accumulated wisdom passed down through Guru Sishya Parampara. The basic knowledge being extremely scientific, the superstructure or the physical expression is extremely artistic. Perhaps Indian art is the best exposition where science and art seamlessly fuse with each other, which lends to an expression of higher philosophy and paves way for search of the self, which is the highest truth.